So I was having dinner with a friend of mine yesterday, and she said that 3 out of 4 of her grandparents died of cancer. And she mentioned one of the grandparents smoked for 60 years. And I thought to myself, well, no wonder they died of cancer. But interestingly enough, it was the only one that didn't die of cancer. Obviously, I'm not trying to say that you shouldn't care about smoking, that you're fine, and it's all a matter of chances anyway. And you'll see in the video, that's not what I aim. But that does raise some questions. Like, for example, what makes some carcinogens stronger than others? What does it actually mean to be a carcinogen? Are chances equal to everyone? We'll discuss the answer to those questions in this video. Hello everyone, my name is Andrea, welcome to my channel. In this channel, we talk about life sciences, genetics, health, what studying biochemistry is like, and much more. So if you're new, make sure to click the subscribe button so you stay tuned for more. So, carcinogens. A carcinogen is something that has the ability to increase the risk of getting cancer. It normally does so by messing up with the DNA. In other words, causing mutations. This video is part of the cancer series of the channel. If you haven't watched my previous video where I talk about how cancer actually starts, how it begins, I highly recommend doing so before watching this video so you can understand more or less the context. Spoiler alert, I say the word mutations a lot. And chances. I say the word chances a lot. But if there is one take-home message you should keep in mind for this video is that DNA damage is the first step on the road to cancer. So without further ado, let's get started. Number one, obesity. A survey done in the UK showed that only 30% of the people name obesity as a risk factor for cancer. But actually, there is a clear link between these two. Experts say there are 13 different types of cancer that are associated with being overweight. What is not clear yet, though, is the mechanism by which this happens. Some of the reasons these two could be related are chronic low-level inflammation that causes DNA damage over time, adipose tissue producing high levels of estrogen, and higher than normal levels of estrogen are associated with breast, endometrial, ovarian, and some other cancers. High levels of insulin and high levels of insulin-like growth factor 1 that may promote the appearance of colon, kidney cancer, and other types of cancer, altered immune response, oxidative stress, among others. Number 2, red and processed meat. Red meat and processed meat have received a lot of media attention throughout the past years. So, according to the World Health Organization, red meat has been classified as group 2A, probably carcinogenic to humans, whereas processed meat has been classified as group 1. Definitely carcinogenic to humans. In the case of red meat, there is a positive correlation between consumption of red meat and cancer, but there is limited evidence and the link between these two is not exactly defined. Whereas in the case of processed meat, there is sufficient evidence. In fact, it's very serious. There is actually a link between the consumption of processed meat and the reduction of lifespan. Studies have shown that both vegetarians and non-vegetarians with a health-conscious diet had a statistically significantly lower overall mortality compared with the general population, not only due to cancer, but also cardiovascular diseases. And what makes processed meat so potentially dangerous? It is thought to be a consequence of the additives, the chemicals that are added during the processing of the meat, such as nitrates and nitrites to help keep the freshness for longer, the HCAs and PCAs that are produced when the meat is cooked at high temperatures, and the red pigment found in red meat that at certain levels can start to be potentially dangerous. Number 3, drinking a bit too much. Surprisingly for many, alcohol is also considered a group 1 carcinogen. It's funny because if you ask a random person in the street what the effects of drinking too much are, they would probably say something like, you know, car accidents or a drunk fight outside a bar. However, there is a strong link between alcohol and cancer that nobody seems to talk about. When our bodies metabolize alcohol, a substance called acetaldehyde is produced. The liver is capable of eliminating up to 99% of this substance, so it should be fine. But the more you drink, the more exposed you are to this acetaldehyde, and the more chances it has of becoming potentially mutagenic. Then there's also the oxidative stress associated with drinking and many other factors. For example, the alcohol concentration will determine how much it affects your cells. And it makes sense. I mean, if you think of it, when you take a glass, a full glass of vodka with like 40% of alcohol, you're exposing your cells in your oral cavity, in your esophagus, in your pharynx to this high amount of alcohol. And that can be good. So if cells start to get damaged, this cytotoxicity will trigger, you know, cells to divide to make up for the damage. And we don't want to cause this damage too often because we don't want these cells to proliferate too often, because that's when the danger comes. I have to say, I already knew, obviously, that alcohol is not good for our health, right? And that it causes oxidative stress and so on and so forth. But after doing the research for this video and realizing how strong the link is, I've also realized that I need to make some changes in my life. Like, it's a serious thing.
They ask you how you are, you just have to say that you're fine when you're not really fine, but you just can't get into it because they...
It is recommended not to drink more than one drink a day if you're a woman and two drinks a day if you're a man. And no, that doesn't mean you get to drink 7 to 14 drinks on a Saturday. As long as you don't drink for the rest of the week. That's not how it works. Number 4, sun. This is something I find rather paradoxing. We need sun in order to produce vitamin D. Like, we need it. We have the precursor, but we need the sunlight for it to actually become vitamin D. And in order to have good amounts of this vitamin, we would need to be exposed to the sun 20 to 30 minutes a day, 3 times a week, without any sunscreen. Which is why in most of the Western world, especially in northern countries, many people have a vitamin D deficiency. However, the same way 30 minutes can be beneficial, more than that can be potentially very harmful, particularly during peak hours. So it's the perfect representation of the saying, enough is as good as a feast. Also part of this cancer series, I made a video a while ago on how UV rays exactly can cause cancer. So I won't go on for long. But long story short, UV rays, and yes, that includes sunbeds, cause a specific damage to our DNA called thymine dimers. Two nucleotides in our DNA getting glued together, a damage that can inhibit DNA replication unless it's repaired. And of course, it's normally repaired, like our bodies have been exposed to sunlight for millions of years, they know what to do, but as it always goes in biology, the more you're exposed to the sun, the more damage it creates, the higher the chances. You know how it goes. Don't make me say the word chances again. Number 5, farmed salmon. This was a big shock to me. I'm still depressed. I'm the biggest salmon fan. So basically, it has been observed that farmed salmon can have higher than usual levels of some toxins. But what's interesting is that it has been seen that the concentration of the residues, when you compare farmed salmon to wild salmon, so like salmon just swimming in nature, it's 2 to 11 times higher in farmed salmon. Also, another study that analyzed 700 samples concluded that farmed salmon has much higher levels of, wait for it, flame retardants, which is an additive used in electronics and furniture. According to researchers, it's not recommended to eat farmed salmon more than twice a month. I'm screwed. Number 6, smoking. Wow, smoking, so unexpected.
Wow.
Okay, but do you know why or how smoking actually causes cancer? There are poisons in tobacco that induce changes and damage in the DNA. There are over 5,000 chemicals in tobacco, of which 70 are directly linked to cancer. Aside from this DNA damage, tobacco can also weaken your immune system, which debilitates its response towards new cancerous cells. And I know you all know this, but that doesn't mean I don't need to mention it. But there is no safe level of smoking. Even secondhand smoking, which is inhaling the smoke from another person's cigarette, can also be dangerous. Which is why, if you know me at least a little bit, you know that I hate tobacco. I hate the smoke of cigarettes. I absolutely hate them. And I made this conscious decision of not smoking because I don't want to do that to my body. And more often than not, I'm just sitting at a table at a bar surrounded by people that are all smoking. So I have no chance but to secondhand smoke or just cover my face with my shirt, which is a bit odd, but I do that a lot actually. And I have to say, since I'm already getting too excited with the topic, it's interesting because smoking is the most widely known carcinogen. If you ask a random person on the street, once again, to name something that causes cancer, probably the first thing that will come to their mind is smoking. Yet so many make this conscious decision of knowingly do something that will do no good whatsoever to your body. At the same time, I must say, I can imagine it must be super hard to quit once you're already addicted. I watched a super interesting video about quitting smoking that I will link down below in case you're interested. Number 7, infectious diseases. I feel like there's a common misconception, well, I don't know if it's common, but there is a misconception that cancer is an infectious disease. And no, one does not transmit cancer to one another. That's not how it works. However, interestingly, there are some infections that can lead to the development of cancer. The most known one would have to be human papilloma virus, which is the worldwide leading cause of cervical cancer. There are over 40 HPV types, of which 13 can cause cancer. They do so by potentially transforming normal cells into cancerous cells when the immune system fails to eradicate the virus entirely. 10% of women with HPV infection on their cervix will develop long-lasting HPV infections that can lead to cervical cancer. And this, ladies and gentlemen, is the reason why most teenage girls are vaccinated against this virus in many countries. Number 8, asbestos. Asbestos is something that is found in rocks and soil, widely used in construction, car materials, ceilings, and so on. But when asbestos breaks, the fibers in it can be inhaled, potentially building up in your lungs. Over time, the accumulation of asbestos can cause tissue inflammation, and this can help the appearance of different health problems, not just cancer. And guess who are more affected? Smokers, as their airways are normally more irritated. It is classified as a group 1 carcinogen, which means there is obviously a lot of awareness towards exposure to asbestos and using materials that contain it. However, workers in industries such as construction and textile can be more frequently in contact with asbestos-containing products, which might primarily affect third world countries, where the use of asbestos may not be as highly regulated. And now the extra risk factor for cancer, stress. While writing the script for this video, I asked you guys on Instagram, what are a few things in our daily lives that you think can cause cancer? And a few people mentioned stress, which I found funny because I hadn't even considered putting it in this list. The question is, can stress really cause cancer? It has not been 100% proven that there is a cause and effect relationship between stress and cancer. However, there are certain effects of stress that could help the development of this disease. Stress can weaken your immune system, which once again will stop it from being 100% effective to fight cancer cells. It can also alter the levels of some hormones that you produce in your body, which can lead to an overactivation of this hormone-producing glands. And you know what happens when something is overactivated and cells proliferate a lot. Also, excessive levels of stress hormones can promote carcinogenesis by inducing DNA damage accumulation and through other mechanisms. And it can also lead to unhealthy behavior such as smoking and drinking, and you know, it's all related. However, I'm now referring to mainly chronic stress. It's not this one day you're stressed because you are late to a meeting. That wouldn't really apply for this. Unless you're late for meetings every day and you're stressed every day because of that, then yes, then it's chronic stress. Okay, now that we've made it to this point of the video, I have two important disclaimers to make. As you may have learned in the previous videos of the series, not everybody has the same risk of developing cancer after exposure to these agents, even if it's in the same amount, as genetics also play a key role. For example, those who have a deficiency or an overactivity in enzymes that are involved in the process of metabolizing alcohol have a higher risk of developing alcohol-related cancers than those who don't. And number 2, I think it's more than clear, but just because these are carcinogenic agents doesn't mean that they will 100% cause cancer. The same way, just because some things are in the same group classified as, for example, group 1, doesn't mean they're equally as risky. For example, asbestos and smoking are in the same group as processed meat, which is group 1, but this doesn't mean that they're equally as risky. This means that there is clear evidence that suggests a link and association between cancer and these factors. Thanks a lot for watching. I hope you liked the video. Make sure to hit the like button if you did so, and leave a comment down below suggesting any topics for any future videos, and see you in the next video. Bye!